All right, guys, I was going to try to bring my son Max in and maybe another special guest, but this doesn't appear to have Skype on it, so we will not be able to do that this evening. And my son has already left the building, so I can't. Yeah.
Can I make your local? You have a power supply for your laptop, too?
Yeah, it's right here. Is it not plugged in?
No.
That's great. Thank you.
Just in case.
Well, I'm going to be, I'll go ahead and just use this here. Let's. All right, guys. My name is Wes Johnson. I do a lot of voices for video games. Perhaps you've played a couple of them. I hope that you played a couple of them. I've been in a number of the Elder Scrolls games, starting back with Morrowind. Jacob, just bring those up back here, sir. You didn't bring the cups. No. It's something different. All right, just here. Don't let anybody. That's all right. All right. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. We're okay. Now, I have. Morrowind is where I started. Went to Oblivion in the Elder Scrolls series, where I played every single character you ever met. Then they scaled me back just a wee bit for Skyrim. I've also had a chance with Bethesda to play in Fallout 3, where I played the Protectrons, the Sentry Bots, the Tracker Yokels from Point Lookout, Scribe Bigsley, and all of the super mutants, including Fox and Uncle Leo, which was great. Good times, an Uncle Leo fan over there. And then moved recently to Fallout 4, which was a lot of fun, where I played Mo Cronin trying to get you to get a swatter. Anybody got a swatter out here today? We got any swatters in the room? I thought we had one.
Got a swatter.
A hefty one, something like a hickory. You know, that's fine. What? You like mahogany? That's too soft. No. It's too. It might smell good when it's getting whacked upside your head.
Aromatic.
Hickory, man. And when somebody hit them upside the nose with that, then you're gonna know aromatic. I also got to do the Silver Shroud. Death has come for you, evil doer, and I am its shroud. That was great because I grew up loving all the old-time radio programs, especially like the shadow that was drawn from. And I also had a little bit of Adam West in there as well. So it was, you know, if you can mix Adam West and Orson Welles, then that's one heck of an actor right there. Some might say that if you mix Adam West and Orson Welles, you have William Shatner, but that's another story. I've done a number of Star Trek games, which was fun. Speaking of William Shatner, I got a chance to, before the Star Trek Legacy came out with all five captains, they hadn't signed him yet. So I got a chance to do his voice as Captain Kirk. There's different Captain Kirks. There's Captain James T. Kirk of the Starship Enterprise from the later movies, Spock. But then there's Captain Kirk from the original Star Trek, where everything is much quicker. He's walking around saying, yes, this is my ship. My ship Bones. I won't have it any other way. So I got a chance to do that character from the original Star Trek for that, and the version that went to E3 was not William Shatner, it was actually me. So that was pretty cool. And then in order to get William Shatner to sign on, they took that and showed it to him, and he was like, well, I don't want anyone else playing the captain. All right, fine, I'll do it. So William Shatner did do the captain in Star Trek Legacy. And then a couple years later, Chris Pine came along and Shatner was like, damn. So now you've got Captain Kirk's running here, there, everywhere. But I got a chance to do a number of Klingons, which was great because I was able to say things like, you have no honor. across ship to ship to Captain Picard, Patrick Stewart, who's awesome, and I've never met him, but I've voiced characters that have interacted with him in two video games. So that's almost like meeting him. Or it's kind of like recording something in your house and splicing it together with Star Trek Generations. That's as much meeting with Patrick Stewart as I actually have. So, although I almost, I was at a place where he was getting a sandwich in D.C. called Sutton Place Gourmet, and someone was like, Patrick Stewart's downstairs. I'm like, what's he doing downstairs? Eating a sandwich. So, you know. By the time I got down there, evidently he was a quick eater, and boom, he was gone, like Kaiser Sose. So what can you do? What? No, he didn't. He didn't know I was coming, but he felt my presence, and he split just like this microphone and the cable just did. So I've also done a few films, and I have a little film demo. Would anyone like to see it? All right, this hopefully works. And it doesn't appear to have any sound, so that's awesome. All right. And we're plugging in the sound. There we go. Let's, it's paused. Let's see if this, here we go. That was great, though. That was great.
I was like, I don't remember you plugging that in. That was the... Click on the sound icon down there. Let's just see where it is. Whether it's turned up or turned down.
That was a good look for me.
Okay.
So where are we at here? Why is it not...
Actually, mind if I drive for a second?
You drive. No, this is going to complicate things, isn't it?
It's not getting sound.
We've traced the phone call.
There you go.
It's coming from inside the elevator.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the beginning.
We've traced the phone call. It's coming from... inside the elevator.
What are you wearing?
Tonight on America's Most Wanted.
Oh, Mrs. Staples, my name is Fat Freak Frank, and I'm your daughter's number one fan.
Why would I get
you flowers? Well, I didn't do anything wrong. Oh, hold on. That'll be $8. I am all about the romance.
Gentlemen, Mr. Mayskilling.
Guys, I just want to say, hey, I'm all for labor, I'm all for unions, but you know and I know that you guys are going to endorse Lewis.
It's a business decision. We're going to do what's best for the union. By the way, if you decided on a running mate...
We're thinking about it.
Well, we think maybe you should consider Sanders.
Well, we're considering several options.
Well, maybe you should also consider being a supporter of the referendum.
Well, that depends.
Can what's up with this guy?
And this is what I always wanted to do. I know I can do this. I can... I just give it...
Whoa. We don't like getting our picture taken, please.
I got you. I understand. Look, what's this going to take, huh? What do you need? $5? Little Amish Lincoln?
I think the two of you need to show a little more respect.
Oh,
what a dick.
Now, this was a neat trick. No one ever did it before. Identified a cell phone using time and GPS. We got everything on the phone that was text messaging from those coordinates at 16:45 hours today. Just a subpoena. With this, you can get account information and a phone number. And with a search warrant, you can get 2 months of text messages.
You've got 2 months of text messages in this file.
I do. If you got a warrant.
I tell you what, friend. We're going to go back home and we're going to start typing that warrant tomorrow morning. But right now, we wouldn't mind just taking a peek at what my man's been up to the last...
Did Miss Marsh have any boyfriends?
Not that I know. The only man I see coming around the house is the ex-husband.
Sean's father. David.
Yeah, yeah.
You think the kid is dead?
We have no reason to believe that, Mr. Resnick.
You see these faces, the posters in the paper. Every time I toss out a milk carton, I wonder if that kid made it back alive.
And there's the bell. Hollywood Haywood coming out, throwing punches, literally running it. He is now attacking Albini and Will. Albini arms into his body like weights, occasionally throwing a weak punch. The punches are flying. It's a flurry. All Hollywood is just, oh, my goodness! Out of nowhere, a right punch by Albini and taking Hollywood Haywood to the head.
Even like right before all this happened, I remember he invited my father and myself and to go out to lunch with him. He just seemed pretty normal, like nothing was going wrong at all.
So how do you like working for Dad so far? He can be real rough, huh?
I mean, it's going good. I'm working hard, learning a lot.
Well, just don't work too hard. You know, as Dr. Frankenfurter said in Rocky Horror, give yourself over to absolute pleasure. And 18-year-old bourbon.
But finally, in one explosive moment, Scott's jovial mask fell away.
Well, she's not a princess anymore because the evil stepmother stole her crown when she was...
the winner of the Miss Montana contest. But her dreams of becoming Miss America crash and burn when she breaks her leg a week before the competition. And this guy's buddies, they're like, yo, man, you wake up in bed in Vegas with a girl and a ring on your finger, that doesn't mean you gotta stick with it, right? And this guy's like,
the ring is a manifestation of the bond we share as man and wife.
Maybe it's me, but I tell you what, I'm seeing something really beautiful.
You seen my woman?
Well, no, I mean, not exactly, no, but you understand.
My woman? She left me.
Hey, that's okay.
Baby, close your eyes and listen to the music. Dig to the summer breeze. Here's your groove and I can show you how to use it. And come along with me and put your mind at ease.
You gotta be fucking kidding me!
You kidding me, right?
Mr. Conway, I didn't
fuck through dancing.
Intimidate the brother, you see. That's what you'll be learning here at the Wing Chatter School.
And you should turn off your cell phones and pages.
There they are.
Oh, how do you like it?
Oh, what is it?
You're eating Diabest new taste sensation, chocolate covered slug. You're on TV, sir.
Water. Where it all began.
Every week we face the toughest schedule known to man.
Have I not?
What? Lips in which to run across your face.
Saddam Hussein, don't be afraid. Come in, sit down.
Good.
Directly ahead of you is Mount McKinley. At 71,000 some feet, it is nearly 50,000 feet higher than your current altitude.
Pull up!
Pull up!
That was Ted Leonsis there at the end, yeah. The owner of the Caps, and a couple days later, he came back to me, got a message from Ted Leonsis, like, how do I get the sticky stuff out of my hair from the makeup that we had to do and put the latex on him and things of that sort. Now, I've talked a lot about, I'm very proud of my three sons. I've got Ben, Sam, and Max. And Max right now is out at the Savannah College of Art and Design. He used to come to all of the MAGFests with me. But right now, Max, you can pop your head up here. I'm going to turn around and show everybody here. Max is on here. He's hiding his face. But everybody say, hi, Max.
That's intimidating.
What's that, Max?
That's very intimidating.
Yeah. Now, Max, we're going to show a couple of your bits here. Tell us exactly what the fun show is about.
The fun show. That was my attempt to entertain and educate this nation's youth. So I decided to make a kid show because drawing pictures good is all I'm really good at. I'm not talented in any other way. So really the only thing I can do to educate kids is make cartoons for them. So this is my attempt to do that.
All right. Max will be watching as you watch him. This is very meta. So everybody... presenting, a little Blues Clues education might help. Here is Max Johnson with The Fun Show.
Yeah, if you don't like it,
I'm very upset. Hit the full screen button. Son, you're fucking...
That's not it.
No. You just ruined the whole thing.
You ruined the whole thing, Sam.
Yeah, I'm sure I did.
All right, there we go. Here we go.
Oh, hi. I didn't see you there. See, I'm actually in a bit of a pickle right now. I was about to finish a drawing here in my sketchbook when I lost my pen. Do you think you can help me find it?
No.
Great. Where should we start looking? Oh, hey there, mysterious stain. Do you think you can help me find my pen? Wow, that was very racist and not helpful to me at all. Who else can I check with? Oh, I know. I'll summon Mr. Blobby.
Sharuka, Alugatashan, Shitulashi.
Oh, hey, Mr. Blobby. Have you... You seen my magic pen? You have? Where? Let's follow him. Oh, wow. Look, guys. It's the Raft of Medusa, a painting depicting a group of shipwrecks who starved at sea. Let's see if they know where my pen is. Excuse me, sir. Do you know where my magic pen is?
What? Where did you come from? Please help me. I'm so cold and hungry. Please, help me.
No. I'm looking for my magic pen. Have you seen it?
Magic pen? Please, if I don't get food soon, I'm going to have to eat my own son. Please help me.
Well, this guy's not very much help. Guess I'll go back to the house.
No, wait. Take me with you, please. Oh, Lord, forgive me for this.
I guess I'll never find my magic pen. Mr. Stain, you had my magic pen this whole time? You son of a bitch, give me that shit. Finally, I can finish my picture in my sketchbook. Let's see. Ah, here we go. Perfect. It's famous actor John Lovitz with the body of a crab. Thanks for coming in this week, guys. It's been a real treat. For next week's episode, I'm gonna burn in hell. Mr. Blobby, shave me down.
Ladies and gentlemen, Max Johnson. All right, I know. It's a direct result of his childhood. That's true. And did it blank out on you there, Max?
Yep.
All right, now.
My phone sucks.
Which is another direct result of your childhood. So I want to show you one more from Max. This one here is low fuel. Is there anything you want to say about this, Max? Can y'all see him? Very small picture there. What do y'all think of Max's work so far? And it's frozen. Did you hear them, son?
No.
Let's try one more time. What do you think of Max's work?
Yes, thank you. Last one night. Oh my God.
Yeah. So you think it's twisted enough? Yeah. Is it funny enough? Yeah. All right. So we'll keep sending you some college tuition. All right. Max, thank you, buddy. That went over very well, and I'll be back in touch with you shortly. Okay. See you, bud. Oh, everybody say bye, Max. They're saying they love you from the back, but I take that very cautiously. See you later, bud. All right, there he goes. Now, I also have Sam back there. Without him, we would not be doing the computer here today. So everybody say, thanks, Sam. Yeah, I'm a doomed man. All right. So now I have a couple of stories here. I know. I put this out online, and a lot of people said that they wanted to hear these. I have never actually put these stories out before. So if there's any way, if you are recording for just a couple of minutes, we can pause these because they are unpublished, and I hope that they will be at some point. But in the meantime, oh, I want to let everybody know, by the way, Max is on YouTube. If you want to go look at some of his other work, it's Max Johnson, Inc., I-N-K. So go look for Max Johnson. You'll see a picture that looks like the animations of you just saw, a self-portrait of his face. And go ahead and follow him on YouTube, okay? Yeah, he could use some nice followers. One of these days, I'll be out there in the crowd watching him up here, and that'll be kind of nice. So now I've done a couple of short stories and novellas, and I wanted to go ahead and read those here today. They're a little macabre. Are you okay with that? All right, so here we go. Now, you'll have to forgive me on this one. This one is called The Vacation. And how many people here actually speak French? Well, I really apologize to you then. There is a little French in here, and I am going to mangle it. It's going to look like the retirees that Max dropped into the fuel tank. Okay, so that's what that's going to be like. But this one is called The Vacation. So sit back, relax, close your eyes, and let's begin. As he rubbed the sleep from his eyes and struggled to make sense of his surroundings, the man stirred for the first time in ages. He slowly noticed that the blanket on his bed was thin and blue, and that the sheets were crisp and white. It was a single bed, surrounded by machines singing in a slow, quiet symphony of beeps. Nothing was familiar, not even his name. He tried untangling his limbs from the shroud of bed linens, then sat up swiftly in the foreign bed, grabbing the cold metal rail for a brief spell of dizziness. "What's this?" he whispered, touching the bandage across his head. "Gauze. Plenty of it." "It's a hospital?" He reached for the bed's railing to find a nurse's call button attached. Funny how he could know where to find a call button, but his very identity was elusive. The man rang the buzzer not once, but three times. After a pause, he gave it another five taps. "Hello?" he rasped out, spooked by his isolation. "Is there anybody working in this hospital?" Tossing the buzzer aside, he decided to see if his legs worked better than the nurse's call system. He was pleased to see that they did. Pulling himself gingerly free, the man felt the ache of inactivity in every move. "How long have I been here?" he asked, cleared his throat with a cough, and swinging his legs over the side of the bed, he began to stretch. He found the sound of his joints popping oddly satisfying and reassuring. Carefully, he attempted to put weight on his legs, and though he wobbled like newborn Bambi, his legs proved sturdy enough to carry his skeletal frame. For a long time, he stood by the bed, looking for answers in the off-white walls. The only breaks in the startlingly sterile room seemed to be a closet door and an entry to the restroom. "Oh, I must be alive," he mumbled, "because I have to pee like a racehorse." In the bathroom, he made two startling discoveries. One was that he had been catheterized. Two was that removing your own catheter can be remarkably painful. For one shattering minute, he couldn't care less about who he was, simply the agony he was going through and wishing he hadn't been so damn stupid. When he could think rationally again, he found himself staring in the mirror at a man he'd never seen before, a gaunt man with bandages covering most of his head. "Mummy, I'm home." A sardonic smile crossed his lean face as he removed the bandages, masking anticipation and horror at what he might find. Beneath the medical turban, His hair was short, thick, respectfully peppered with gray, was unceremoniously parted by a hideous rope of shiny white scar that stretched from temple to temple. How could anyone have lived through this, he thought, cautiously running his fingers across the long, healed scar. How long have I been here? In the closet, he found a suit. It was a nice suit, made of dark wool. The blue of the jacket seemed to clash with the faded blood staining the collar of a dress shirt hanging next to it. The suit had cleaned up well, but the shirt was yet another dramatic example that something had gone horribly, terribly wrong, but the suit looked none the worse for wear. Reaching into the jacket, he found a wallet near the inner vest pocket. A sensible brown wallet should hold nothing to fear, but his mouth grew dry as he opened it to the driver's license. William Harold Blake, Lake Forest, Illinois. That was his name, but it rang no bells. The round, healthy face smiling up from the photo looked almost nothing like the haunted cadaver staring back. A chill ran down his spine, and it had nothing to do with someone stepping on his grave. It had to do with the realization that his keister was exposed to a very chilly hospital room. Oh, for God's sake, Bill said, clamping the bag shut with his free hand. Thankfully, the nurses hadn't responded to his call yet, so no one had gotten an illicit peek of his bony behind. The blue wool suit looked to be big, but it had to fit better than this peekaboo gown. Bill slid the wallet back into the jacket and proceeded to remove the suit from the hanger for the first time in who knew how long. He ignored the shirt. He didn't want to touch it, let alone wear it. The suit was large, but the belt worked just fine, and after tucking it in, the light blue collarless hospital gown didn't look half bad with the jacket. In fact, he thought he could pass for a tourist. Maybe he had been a tourist. He couldn't be sure. Bill picked up the call buzzer to give the nurses another request for their time. As the loose end of the cord swung out from under the bed and tapped him on the shins, Bill felt his stomach drop. It hadn't been connected. They hadn't expected him to wake up today, or anytime soon for that matter. A nurse's call buzzer is pretty superfluous equipment for someone who's, what, in a coma?
Hello?
Bill called out, nerves evident in his cracking voice.
Is there anyone there?
Bill stared out the door, but was met there by a rather startled-looking doctor. Color drained from the doctor's already pallor-challenged face, and shock filled his rheumy eyes. Good thing this man's in a hospital, Bill thought, because he looks like he could drop at any minute. Here's the bad French.
Que fais for hur dulit?
I don't know. I can probably use your own.
Que fais vos hur dulit?
The doctor said anxiously, leaving Bill more confused than ever. What language was this then? Where the hell am I?
Olit maintenant.
The rotund and heavily breathing doctor pushed Bill backward with pudgy fingers. Bill didn't understand the language, but caught the drift of what the man was saying. The doctor was shocked to see him standing.
Jesus eton de vos de Vermonton,
smiled the roomy doc with teeth like a rotting finch.
C'est remarquable, remarquable.
Do you speak English? Bill asked.
Is there anyone here who speaks English?
The old doctor placed an icy stethoscope under Bill's gown. Incroyable, he said, and Bill knew that what they had here was failure to communicate.
Déchevelez vous la veste, the old doctor exclaimed, perspiration beating his large, hairless forehead.
Bill looked at him helplessly, and the doctor grew frustrated, making large pantomime with his arms to explain what he wanted.
La veste, décollez-la, s'il vous plaît, eh?
Okay, whatever, Bill said as he removed his jacket. Old Dr. Stinky Teeth nodded in approval, reaching for a blood pressure cuff. The doctor was shocked to see Bill conscious, and that frightened him more than the disconnected buzzer had.
Incroyable.
Yeah, blah, 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 Bill replied. When you decide I'm not dead, what are the odds you can get someone in here who speaks English?
Shh,
the doctor hissed, and started pumping the blood pressure cuff again. Bill shushed, shifting silently as an officious-looking man in a serviceable gray suit. Bill shushed. Shifting silently, as an officious-looking man in a serviceable gray suit entered carrying a metallic silver book.
Bill wanted to say something, ask if he spoke English, but since he'd been unconscious, Lord knows how long, another minute of silence wouldn't kill him. The old fact doctor was having a hell of a time taking his blood pressure. Between exclamations and peak, he offered Bill weak smiles to assure all was well. Bill was sure all was not. He imagined this old fart hadn't taken a blood pressure himself in years, and the thin gray man wasn't lifting to help a hand. He was probably an accountant from the looks of him, that metal notebook in his hands, probably carried a bill for months and months of expensive hospital care Bill wasn't sure he could afford. He didn't even know what he did for a living. Merd! The doctor exclaimed, started pumping the cuff once more. This was a word Bill knew, as in up Merd a creek without a paddle. It was a French word, so maybe he was in France. Maybe he had been on vacation. Hope I didn't leave home without my American Express with traveler's checks. Bill smiled. Shh, the doctor commanded once more. Not only was Bill alive now, he was pissed. Even the accountant seemed to think this was ridiculous because he was finally reaching out to offer the doc a hand. Bill watched with exasperation as the accountant placed his hand on the old doctor's back. And the old doctor screamed. What? Bill said as the old man froze into a silent scream. Spasms rocked the doctor as his hands left Bill's arm and clutched frantically at his own chest. Bill pulled back, shocked, horrified, and then saw something that made him doubt his sanity. The accountant was pulling what appeared to be a ghostly, vaporous version of the old French doctor out of his back. Bill's jaw hung open as the little man snapped, the writhing, shrieking soul loose like a wet sheet, and proceeded to fold it again and again, all the while listening dispassionately as it wailed bloody murder. Once he had the soul folded into a small, thin square, he unzipped a small black pouch strapped to his side. Tucked in. And then tucked the soul inside the pouch and zipped it shut. What kind of monster are you? Bill croaked, his mouth dry, his limbs shaking. He looked to the floor and saw the old doctor was not moving. What's happening? The thin man in gray looked up at Bill quizzically. For a long moment, there was nothing but silence. Then the man spoke. Are you talking to me? You speak English? Bill asked. He felt nauseous. No, the accountant said. I don't. You can see me, hear me. Bill nodded. The man in gray opened his silver book and began flipping through the pages. No, no, he said. This is wrong. You shouldn't... The man in gray paused. He looked up at Bill. For a horrible moment, it seemed as if he would move towards him. I have to go, the accountant mumbled, snapped the book shut, and fled the room. Bill watched the door for what seemed like forever, and then he began screaming. The next few minutes happened in a slow-motion blur as his world, what he knew of it, tilted on its axis. Nurses, so sparse a few moments ago, came out of the woodwork. Screaming was a far more effective tool than a disconnected call button for getting attention. And when they saw the doctor on the floor, all hell broke loose. Emergency crash carts flooded the room, and Bill was lost in the shuffle. He wanted to tell them that there was no hope. As they cut away the old man's shirt and began shocking his chest, he wanted to tell them no amount of electricity worked because the old doctor was empty. The shell was hollow. He'd seen what happened with his own unbelieving eyes. After what seemed an eternity, Bill just wandered out of the hospital room and strayed down the bustling, overly bright hallway. Nobody noticed him in his smart blue wool suit as he waded through the madness and the flickering fluorescent light. Or so he thought.
Et où stood le bon, monsieur?
Security guard asked, placing a large callous hand on Bill's shoulder and eyeing the hospital gown under his jacket suspiciously. I'm sorry, Bill said. I don't speak French.
American?
The guard asked in fractured English. Bill nodded.
You are a patient here, monsieur.
Yes, Bill said absently. He wasn't really here speaking to this large man who must have been made back when meat was cheap. He was replaying the old doctor's death in his mind's eye. I'm a patient, but somebody else needed my... Bill stopped abruptly. Down the hallway, the man in gray had entered a pair of double doors to an operating suite. He entered through the doors, even though they were closed at the time.
Ah!
Bill yelled, gripping the guard by his huge arm and pointing aggressively toward the operating room.
There! There he is!
Who, monsieur? The doctor asked.
Who are you speaking of?
The man, Bill shouted.
The killer! He went in those doors!
Killer? I've seen no one, monsieur.
He's there, Bill shouted, wrenching his arm free
of the guard and sprinting toward the OR doors. The guard was quickly on his heels, having seen no killer, but pretty sure he had a lunatic on his hands. Bill rammed into the doors of the operating room, pressing his face against the glass to see a procedure already in progress. Bill couldn't have known that the patient was a heavy-set elderly woman. But somehow he did. He did because the man in gray was there, the accountant from hell, and the accountant was collecting a soul.
No!
Bill howled as he watched the soul being wrenched, screaming and twisting away from the efforts of the surgical team. The little man's eyes flicked nervously to Bill, who at the moment found his face being pushed brutally against the glass by a very large hand.
Monsieur! Shouted the guard as he twisted Bill's thin arm behind his back. Please, come with me.
He's killing her, Bill said. You have to stop him.
Who is, monsieur?
The man in gray, the accountant. He's taking her soul, even as we speak. The guard held Bill with an iron grip, yet his eyes showed apprehension.
Monsieur, let me take you somewhere, to someone who can help you, eh?
I'm not crazy, Bill pleaded. He's in there right now. He'll get away with her soul if you don't stop him. The security guard, who would have loved a career change just about now, did his best to restrain Bill with one arm while reaching for his walkie-talkie with the other. Bill thrashed wildly as the man in gray materialized sheepishly through the operating room door and tried to slip past him.
No! Bill shouted. Stop him!
With strength belying his bony frame, Bill grabbed at the man in gray. His hand slipped through him as if he wasn't there.
Damn you! Bill cried, and with one last great swipe,
actually made contact with something. It wasn't the man in gray himself. It was his silver book. The man in gray spun, alarmed that this human had actually somehow touched him. The silver book fell to the floor and separated from the phantom. It hit with a resounding and very real clatter. The noise startled the security guard, whose grip on Bill loosened just enough for him to break free, grab the silver book, and run.
Stop!
Cried the guard, but Bill didn't stop. He ran as fast as his feeble legs would carry him. The book felt hot in his hands. Bill imagined it was guilt. Whoever raised me, Bill thought, did a pretty good job in the shame department. Bill's lungs were afire, and a stitch was spreading its painful message down his right side. The message was that Bill hadn't exercised in a long, long time, and this body wasn't quite ready for the Olympics. Ducking into a supply closet, Bill pulled the book to his chest and gasped for air. He hoped he'd lost the security guard, but he wasn't sure. He just knew he had to stop running. Truth be told, Bill feared the security guard far less than the button-down boogeyman dressed in no-nonsense gray. He had seen that demon slide through solid doors. A supply closet door was no match for a creature that could see into souls and pluck them loose like so much meat from a Maine lobster. After a few moments, his breathing eased, and Bill got the feeling that the boogeyman wasn't coming, that he had indeed slipped the security guard. He also had a deep, warm feeling, a warm feeling that was coming from the silver book. What are you? Bill whispered to the book. Death, it seemed to whisper. Bill held the book away from his chest. Did it just speak to him? Couldn't have, but he thought the answer was yes. Bill dropped the shining book, and as it lay before him on the floor, it beckoned. It wanted to be picked up, to be read, to teach secrets no mortal man was meant to know. Bill wasn't sure how he knew it, but the book wanted him. It wanted him badly. Maybe, Bill mused softly, maybe I can stop the man in gray. Yes. If If I can stop him, then I might know why I woke up from my coma when I did. Yes, this isn't an instrument of evil. No, it's just an instrument, a book that needs to be read. Bill lifted the book from the floor and he could feel it hum against his flesh as he opened it to a page at random. The pages were dense with a glowing, indecipherable scrawl that made him squint from its brilliance. He closed his eyes and felt the radiance of its contents wash over him. Don't read with your eyes. Read with your soul. Bill opened his eyes. He knew what he was looking at. The doctor, Jean-Pierre Machand, was right there on the page. The time and date of his death were so clearly marked as if it had been preordained. The woman in the opera, and her name was Marie Giraud. She'd been the last on this list to go. Bill didn't look at all the names before the doctor, but he could see that the man in gray had been a very busy little spook. "Damn you," Bill whispered. "You're not getting another as long as I have this book." The fear of the unknown had been daunting, but now it was replaced by an unholy anger. Maybe he didn't know who he was, but he knew what he felt. And at this moment, Blake felt like a burning desire for revenge. Not many people get a chance to cheat death in their lifetime. Bill was on a roll. He had cheated death by surviving whatever accident had taken his memory, and he cheated death twice more just now. Bill felt that God himself must be speaking to him through this book, and that made his mission a holy one. The next name on the list sang out to Bill. It was a man, one Francis Cloutier, who was currently dining at a restaurant one block from this very hospital. Bill didn't read this in the book. He just knew. The book, or God through the book, was leading him directly to where he needed to go. "Now," the book said, and Bill exited the supply closet. The guard was nowhere to be seen, so Bill made his way to the elevator. As he traveled to the first floor, Bill had to close his eyes. Every face had a time stamp on it. The old woman that smelled of expensive perfume had less than 6 months to live, and no toilet water could mask the smell of the cancer baking deep within her bowels. The executive with the distasteful look on his face was much more attractive now than he would be in April, when he would eat the service end of a pistol he kept next to his tax portfolio. And the young boy making a delivery would die tragically 2 years from now in a traffic accident. As the doors opened and Bill clawed his way out of the mobile tomb, he shouted, "Always fasten your seat belts!" Running from the stale chloroformed air of the hospital, Bill thought that he might scream out of madness. The streets of Paris were congested, yet majestically beautiful. For a tourist, this would be sheer bliss. But with the book in his hand, Bill can sense nothing but death all around him. Impending death, imminent death, and death that had come and gone for centuries past. The book sang a dirge to all around him. The restaurant was only one block away, and yet to Bill, it was like traveling through the valley of the shadow of death. And though he did fear all evil, he couldn't stop himself. No one else would die this day, not if he could help it. "Montreal's the idiot!" shouted a man who shoved past Bill with a hard, angry shoulder. "You'll die alone in your own fluids!" Bill shouted back, and though he didn't speak French, Bill had a strange feeling that the frightened man understood. As he briskly marched the sidewalk in front of this ancient, impressive Paris hospital, Bill clutched the silver book to his chest, feeling its heat and fearing its strange powers. Death was thicker in the air than the smell of the nearby Rhone, its essence barely staved off by the fleshy shells that pump blood on an oh-so-temporary basis. He could hear the mundane and petty thoughts of those who brushed past him, each one frantic to get here or there before the gossamer thread that tied them to this mortal coil finally snapped. The man in gray? He was some sort of parasite. A grisly collector of souls, no better than a vulture devouring a carcass. The man in gray watched and waited for the gossamer thread of life to unravel. And if it wasn't quick enough, Bill was sure the officious little ghoul carried a small pair of golden scissors to snap things along. But not today. No one would die today if Bill could help it. Le Rivage was a classic French restaurant in the heart of Paris, renowned for its fine traditional cuisine. Tourists and locals alike had patronized the restaurant since its inception just after World War II. The outdoor cafe was popular, particularly on a beautiful sunny day such as this. Francis Cloutier had been eating his lunch at Le Rivage for the past 22 years, and his midsection showed how rich and fattening such a diet could be. At 65 years of age, Cloutier was one heart attack waiting to happen, and no one would have been surprised. After all, at 5'9" tall and weighing an impressive 325 pounds, Cloutier could best be described as round. The staff at Le Rivage kept two things very close when Mr. C arrived for lunch. One was a large supply of freshly prepared snails. The other was the number for the French Emergency Medical Service, or sapeurs-pompiers. But as the plate of escargot arrived at his usual seat on the outdoor cafe, not one member of the staff expected Mr. C to choke. After all, he'd been a professional swallower for many years. His chewing technique was perfect. No one living expected him to die in that manner. No one, except for Bill Blake. Diable, shouted Cloutier, as Bill swatted a fork full of snails off the large man's grasp. Diable, vous présente, vous face! I'm saving your life, Bill shouted, and shoved the remainder of the plate onto the sidewalk. That's what I'm doing. Vous abrutez! Cloutier bellowed and clopped Bill viciously on the side of his head. The silver book nearly dislodged from Bill's grasp as he went down. And from the corner of his eye, he could see the man in gray. The accountant from hell was here, standing on the edge of the rapidly growing crowd, nervously eyeing his precious silver object. Clutching the book tightly, Bill stood and searched for an opening to run. The crowd and a sudden hand on the collar of his jacket held him tight. Là où est Vaus, allant abruté. I told you it's bad. Cloutier hissed as he jerked Bill back and swatted him once more. Vous attendez, is there la police pour arriver? Vous mendant maigre. No police, Bill shouted, and pulled himself close to Cloutier, mostly to avoid another blow. No police are necessary. Cloutier was not a tall man, but at the moment he was a mean and angry one. His pudgy fingers squeezed Bill by the lapels and pulled him nose to nose. The fat man spit in Bill's eye, then tossed him to the ground. Vous avez raison. Cloutier laughed, turning his rather wide posterior towards Bill and walking away. Nous devons passer de la police pour faire comme vous. I just gave up on that one. Yes, Bill said softly. Scum like me, who just saved you from choking to death. Bill could feel Cloutier's eyes on his back as he stood and pushed through the crowd. He knew this man didn't have long. No matter how many times he saved him from choking, neither did the waiter who was on the phone calling the police. Too bad, Bill thought. There'll be no one to call the police tomorrow evening when the bandit comes calling. Where to now, Book? Bill asked, but instinctively he knew. Two blocks from here, the intersection. Half an hour from now, he had an appointment, or rather, the man in gray did. Bill noticed the demon fleeing the restaurant as soon as it was certain Cloutier would live. Bill chuckled despite his nerves. Someone's going to be in big trouble with the boss. Bill walked slowly toward the deadly intersection. There seemed to be more time now, and something was urging him to soak in his surroundings, to play the tourist. The streets were a grand mix of small storefront and huge ancient buildings. Small street vendors hawked their wares with an air of weariness, and business people bustled past with their heads down and their eyes averted. Bill could see the end for each of them and marveled how none of them spent more time living in the moment. He wanted to grab them, shake them, and scream that they were wasting their time on petty miseries. But the little tussle with Cloutier was all his bony frame could handle in one day. Bill gazed at the magnificent gardens that grew between the buildings and understood that they would die shortly as well. To every season, turn, 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 he thought, and sat down on the marble base of a statue to wait for his next meeting with destiny. As he waited, Bill turned the book slowly in his hands. and watched people passing by as he had never done before. He was no longer running from the knowledge the book gave him, but he was comforted by it. The book was his friend, and it would help him in any way it could. It was telling him this. The book was singing to him, seducing him. And Bill liked it, God help him. Bill liked it a lot. He no longer cared who he really was. Did it matter? He had a purpose, something many people with identities never had. Bill held death in his hands, surveying its sleek silver cover and slowly sinking into its embrace. His mission was to make sure it would never feed again, and as long as he breathed, death held no purchase in his corner of the world. He is near. Bill knew the man in gray was here, but didn't see him. Bill sensed the demon was nervous. Good. Bill would have been nervous himself if it weren't for the power and courage that flowed into him from the book. The man in gray hovered just out of Bill's sight, but he wouldn't for long. The time was almost here. The time when Pierre Brisebois would cross the street, intersect with the grill of a car, and traverse into the afterlife. Only not today. Not on Bill's watch. Not when life and death were so close, so apparent to him. He could see Pierre Brisebois as the young man strode towards his fate without a care in the world. Bill closed his eyes and held the book close. He could feel the joy of the doomed man, feel his heart, feel his fate. Pierre Brisebois was very happy that afternoon. He'd finally summoned up the nerve to ask Patrice to marry him. It had only taken him 6 months to screw up the nerve, and when she said yes, he wondered why he'd been so nervous to begin with. Theirs was the perfect love, he thought, destined to last forever. Stepping off the curb and into the street, Brisebois was blind to everything but his future with Patrice, so, in the words of the Beatles, he didn't notice that the light had changed. He was so unaware that a presence had followed him, a presence as gray as the Parisian tarmac. Bill's eyes snapped open. He means to take him before I can. The gray man's face twisted with purpose as he appeared on the street, his hand reaching for Pierre Brisebois' back. A block away, a rental car, driven too quickly by a tourist, sped dangerously around a corner, barreling toward the light that gave it right of way. Bill leapt to his feet and scrambled over the curb, racing toward the doomed Pierre Brisebois just as the man in gray touched him. Brisebois' back stiffened and his knees locked just as Bill made contact, shoving him from the man in gray's grasp. Brisebois gasped for air as he slid across the rough pavement. He sat up just in time to see the man who had shoved him laugh with satisfaction, point a finger at nothing and shout, "Not today! Not one soul!" Brisebois then watched as the man who shoved him was brutally shattered by a speeding rental car. Bill's mind reeled. He had felt a great amount of power standing before the man in gray, shoving a triumphant finger directly into his face. Then, shockingly, he felt horrible pain as his kneecaps were broken backwards and his face slammed into the hood of a silver four-door Passat. The immeasurable pain died suddenly as his spine snapped and his body flipped over the roof of the car, splashing to the unforgiving pavement. "The book," his mind screamed. "I've lost the book." Crowds gathered around Bill, many of them shrieking and crying in a language he no longer understood. Someone rolled over him, and the wailing of the crowd increased dramatically. "I wonder if my scar reopened," Bill thought, closing one good eye. Darkness was comforting, and he was ready to accept his failure. He hadn't staved off death. He had just called it to himself. The book had promised him eternity, claimed to be his friend, yet all it had done was to lead him to this sorry end. Bill opened his eye one final time and saw the man in gray standing above him. "No," Bill whispered in a bloody, gravelly rasp. "Please, no." But the man in gray didn't listen. Just as Bill thought the pain of the world was done with him, he felt his soul start to burn as the man in gray pulled, and then began to rip his soul free. Bill screamed like he'd never screamed before, at least as far as he knew. The screaming wasn't physical. His body was now beyond pain, but this agony began where the body ended and raged through eternity, ripping at the fiber of his spirituality and shredding him at the very edges of his being. And then it was over. "I'm sorry," said the man in gray. "You damned idiot," said the being that had been hiding inside William Blake, slapping the face of the man in gray with a preternatural fury.
I said I was sorry," the demon cried. "How was I to know you were vacationing in that room? Because it was in the book, you bloody fool. I'm sorry. What do you want me to say? How about, I'm sorry, Mr. Reaper, sir, for screwing up my assignment and totally buggering the first vacation you were able to take in over a century?" "Do you have any idea how hard it is to find a suitable host body that isn't maimed, burned, or decapitated right in the very city you want to visit? Do you?"
The man in gray shook his head and looked at his shoes. "If I had wanted to be reminded of who I am, Jones, I wouldn't have taken a brain-dead Illinois Husky fan out for a walk. With me, Blake's body could move, speak, and think. I was everything he had been in life minus the soul. All I had to do was go for a ride, enjoy the sensations of life. Damn it, Jones, I didn't even get to have dinner."
Jones stood in silence, absorbing his employer's wrath.
"God damned rookie," Death sighed, and looked back to the crowd surrounding his vacation body.
"Oh, Lord, would you look at this mess?" Death walked to the grotesque gathering and peered at the broken body of William Blake. Blake had been on vacation in Paris when a car first hit him 3 years ago. Seeing him go like this finally was rather ironic. He sighed with the exasperation of a being that had just watched his long save for vacation go down the tubes.
"Pretty funny when you think about it, isn't it?" Death said to Pierre Brisebois. Only Brisebois didn't hear him. Brisebois was busy gawking at what very probably should have happened to him and thanking his lucky stars that it wasn't.
"Should I let you stay, Pierre?" mused Death, looking at the young and presumably healthy man.
"Should I give you and the pretty Miss Patrice a fighting chance at life together?"
Brisebois, blissfully unaware that Death was whispering in his ear, looked on the corpse before him and choked back bile.
"Nah," said Death. "Let's just make it a quick instead of a slow lifetime of grief."
The Reaper whisked the soul from the back of Pierre Brisebois. He did it quickly, effortlessly, and the unlucky Pierre, who had been born with a heart defect he never knew of, was in Death's black satchel before he knew he was doomed. And the suddenly barren body dropped lifelessly onto the former William Blake. Death turned to his cowering apprentice and smiled.
"That, my dear Mr. Jones, is how it's done."
The afterlife accountant known as Jones nodded and resumed looking at his shoes, oblivious to the suddenly louder and decidedly more horrified crowd behind him. Death moved to his understudy's side.
"Jones," Death said, putting his arm over the meek demon's shoulder, "I shall be making a quick visit to a little restaurant known as Le Rivage. Do you know the one?"
"Oh, yes, sir.
I know that you do. I have a Mr. Cloutier to see, and I have a strong hunch that his dessert won't be to his liking. Can I count on you to get back to the office and crunch a few numbers, find me a suitable replacement body for a vacation, and say, Haiti?"
I'll do my best, sir.
Well, I'm afraid I'll need you to do far better than that.
And Jones?"
"Yes, sir."
"Give me my book."
Sheepishly, Jones handed the silver metal book to Death, then dissipated quickly into the ether. Death cuddled the book, stroking the spine as one would a pet. The book responded with a shudder and a contented sigh.
"You missed me, didn't you?" Death said, smiling, as his unearthly companion.
I know, but you must stop being so needy.
I know you led him to me. Jones is foolish, but not so stupid as to knowingly incur my wrath."
The book whimpered and snuggled closer to Death's side.
"All right," Death laughed, "but you're in the doghouse with me."
Death looked on his book and grinned. He knew he couldn't stay mad.
The book knew it too and sent a happy image of pain, destruction, and loss of life to his master's mind. Death stroked the book by its cover and ran his fingers playfully through its pages. "Okay, girl," Death said as he began to slip away into the ether of time and space. "What say we get back to work and make a killing?" I want to thank each and every one of you who stuck it out. That's how you just separate the diehards from those who are lightweight. It's very interesting. We had the guy over here on the corner who was kind of like, "I know you have a mic, but I can be louder as I talk about my laundry." And he's gone. And a few other people getting up and going like, "This person here, thank you. I appreciate you coming for the story. You stuck it out, so I don't count you amongst the others. Thank you." So I have a number of those, and I haven't had them published yet. What do you think? Is that did it keep your attention? Now, how many of you guessed the ending? Anybody guess the ending? There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, that's not so bad. But were you disappointed in it? You knew it was coming, but you were okay? Sort of like Death knew Pierre Brisbois was coming, yeah? All right. And how very disappointed were you with my French? Yeah. Down. I will take a nice resounding boo. Or what would you say in French? Merde? Shoot? It would be like shoot? Okay. Everybody say shoot. For boo. I so freaking deserve that. Now, we have a microphone up here, and I would be very happy to take any questions anybody has about anything, whether it be voice acting, whether it be any of the roles I've done, whether it be what kind of cheese I like. Make your way up to the microphone. Recon Die is now checking the dials, making sure all is well. Thank you, sir. Now, aren't you glad that I did the animation first? Hi, what's your name?
Hi, I'm John.
Hey, John, how you doing?
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
I'm kind of curious, did you draw any inspiration from the Death from Discworld? Because the character was a little similar, except an asshole.
No. It was just a story idea that I've been playing with. I didn't draw any inspiration from it. I'm sure that a lot of people have. I mean, there's Death Takes a Vacation. There are all sorts of things like that. But
well, there was that little detail, but I was mainly I like the wit.
Oh, thank you. As long as it can make you laugh and sleep, I'm happy. Thank you. Hi. How you doing?
Hello.
What's your name?
I'm Josh.
Hey, Josh.
So, I remember at Voice of Palooza, you were reading out cards that people wrote from the audience.
Yes.
And I think it was last year when you read out this card where some guy had written, "Can I get a date?" And you set up a date with someone in that room at that moment.
Oh, yeah. Did they come back?
I was about to ask you if you
was that me. You?
No.
It wasn't you?
No.
Do you want a date tonight? Is that what this is? Yeah? So
actually,
your name is Josh. We know that much. What kind of things do you like, Josh?
Computers.
Video games. Long
really
walks in the woods.
How I expect this to go.
Seriously, are you looking for a guy or a girl, or maybe a little of both? I don't know. You could be very frisky.
Okay, my original question was, do you know?
Oh, the original question. All right, let's get back to that.
My original question was, do you know what happened to that couple? Because I was really curious about that. You offered to marry them next year.
I think he may have ended up on that subreddit murder. Yeah?
They went out, they met at the thing,
they
were going to
the
concert together, right?
Yeah. Oh. Wait a minute. Mark, are you here? I thought I saw Mark back there. His name was Mark.
I haven't seen
They didn't show? So as far as we know, he was murdered. Okay, so it's your chance. So what, do you want to go to a dance with somebody tomorrow? Breakfast in the morning? Le Rivage in France?
How about...
All right, hold on one sec. Stand up here, right up here. Right over here.
Over.
Turn around. Wave to the crowd. All right, how many people out there, by a show of hands, find Josh very attractive? It was about 95% guys.
That 95%
girls. So you want to go for this, or would you like to bail at this particular moment?
No saving bail.
Would you like a lifeline? A lifeline? It's a get out of jail free card. All right, ladies and gentlemen, Josh is now off the market. Hello, sir.
Hey, Wes.
How you doing? What's your name?
I'm Mike.
Mike.
I actually have a follow-up question to something you said at the voice panel earlier. Somebody was asking about how to do soundproofing for building their own studio.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just wondering, for people like me who are currently building a studio in their house, what kind of microphone you are partial to for picking up everything that you need to when you're building it?
It depends on what you want to do with your voice. I mean, I like to be able to get the high crisp end, mm-hmm. as well as get the bass of the voice. Mm-hmm. And I ended up going with a AKG Perception 820, which is really nice. It's a tube mic. It wasn't too expensive. It's hard to find a microphone that will give you a lot of those different ranges and not cost you into the thousands. This one at the time was about $900, so it was great. Now you can get them on eBay or Amazon for about $600, but it's really terrific. What are you using for an interface?
Right now, nothing. We just bought the house. But I currently work in a recording studio. I was looking for a less expensive option than the $4,000 U87 that's
yeah.
in there.
The Perception 820 is really good for me, and you can still find it out there. Mm-hmm. You can get it, like I said, $300 cheaper than I got it, because it's been discontinued, but you can still find it. Mm-hmm. I've been using it now for about 6 years, and I love it. I run through an Avalon 737SP, so it that also allows me to soak the different kinds of qualities I want from that microphone. It really depends. And then your soundproofing, you're getting a whole room, or are you building a separate room inside of a room?
It's basically going to be part of a guest room, so I guess it would be its own.
You're going to have people sleeping in your studio?
It'll be that creepy.
Wow. No, that's what I would... I do recommend that mic. I like it very much.
All right.
Yeah. It also comes with a nice shock mount, so...
Oh, nice. I actually have one follow-up. I'm trying to pull it up.
You're trying to pull it up? Are you trying to get a date up here in front of them and going...
Maybe a little later. I was actually wondering if you could arrest me for my ringtone.
Do a what?
I was wondering if you could arrest me like one of the Oblivion guards for a ringtone.
Okay, sure.
Alright.
Halt, criminal scum! Your stolen goods are now forfeit. Pay the price or serve your sentence. Then pay with your blood!
Thank you so much, Wes.
Three pickpockets and people who had accidentally picked up a fork just fled the outer area.
So you said your son Max was going to SCAD, right?
Yeah, Savannah College of Art and Design, yeah.
I'm going to be going to SCAD in the fall. I was wondering if I might be able to get in contact with Max and talk to him about
Yeah,
what
reach
he's
out
doing.
To me later. We'll be around.
All right, yeah, cool. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. And actually, you know, if you do go on to YouTube and look up Max Johnson, Inc.,
INK. You can also send him a message on there.
Yeah, I actually followed him after you said that. On like I subscribed.
Oh, cool.
To his channel,
well, yeah. So. Drop him a message. Yeah. Tell him you saw his stuff at MAGFest and you're going to SCAD and you want to chat. He'll be perfectly open to that.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Shea Gorath and the Dark Seducer. It's amazing to see myself in the flesh. And to see you, of course, in the flesh. Always a pleasure.
Always here for my Lord Mad Dog.
So much win, yeah.
So, we would like to know, what cheese do you like?
I'm sometimes partial to a lovely Gouda. But I like a pepper jack as well. The Gouda, it's so smooth and soft and creamy. But the pepper jack, it's got some bite.
That it does, yes.
I had another one. But
and the cheddar goes so lovely with brain.
Brain pie, yes.
Ah, perfect.
Would you like to donate?
Care to donate. Remember, go back and listen to that line.
Yeah, I will.
Shea Gorath drops and changes his accent randomly.
Yes,
and
he
goes from Scottish to Irish constantly, but sometimes when he gets malevolent, especially there when he says care to donate, there's no accent at all. So people ask me, they say, is Shea Gorath Scottish or is he Irish? And he's whatever he wishes to be.
I float somewhere in the pirate range.
He's not very piratey.
No,
he's really not.
He's not very pirate at all, no.
He's more Billy Connolly.
Billy Connolly. Yeah.
He's more Billy Connolly is what he is. There's Billy Connolly in there. And he's a stand-up comedian.
Aye, it's...
He is.
Yes.
I'll check him out.
Had himself a lovely colonoscopy. Look it up.
Oh, I'll look that up too.
You guys are awesome. This is great. Ladies and gentlemen, Paul and Aaron, you guys rock. By the way, I want to thank you for having the good taste that if you are wearing those type of pants, have a little sash that covers down the front. I've seen some characters walking around today who have not done us that courtesy. Everything there belongs to the Dark Seducer. No one look.
I'm too short for this.
Hello there.
Hello, Wes. Nice to
howdy,
see
howdy.
You again.
Good to see you.
A few compliments. It was really nice to meet you last year at AwesomeCon and everything. And I'm really glad to catch a panel of yours. It was wonderful to hear your story. A little interesting
thing. I didn't
thing.
Bore everybody at that
no.
panel like I did here today.
No.
So.
And a little interesting thing. I actually found out because I saw your nephew, Ryan Parsons. I've known him for a long time.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
He said, I'm seeing you tonight.
Is Ryan, are you here today?
They went to... go get a different car because of the snow.
That's okay.
So they're coming
they
back.
Hear me talk all the time. At least my son's back there, and we've got Matt and Krista. Hi, guys.
Hi.
But, yeah, just a few compliments of all.
I see Matt and Krista will wave, but Sam is my son, so, of course, he goes, oh, Dad, shut up. So that's...
I do like your
that's
voice
pretty
work
cool.
and everything. I was wondering if you, it's my birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
I was hoping I could get is it Sheragoth from Skyrim? Like a
Sheragoth, cheese for everyone.
Recording of you saying happy birthday. And
well, come up here on the stage and we'll do that here.
Okay, can I have someone just record it for us?
Surely.
It's recording. I will come right there.
Thank you.
Tis a wonderful time. I want each and every one of you to wish her a very happy day of her birth. Give me a huzzah.
Huzzah!
Cheese for everyone.
Cheese for everyone.
Wait. No, scratch that. Cheese for no one. Well, that's just as good a celebration if you don't like cheese, no?
Thank you very much.
Happy birthday.
Thank you very much.
I'll give you a lovely Marriott Mint. There you go. Nah, that's a birthday celebration.
I love it.
The lovely Marriott Mint. Did anybody get those on their pillow?
No.
Did any of yours run away like mine did? I don't know. Hello, sir.
Hello, how are you?
are you?
How you been? We meet again.
I'm doing great. How about yourself?
I'm doing wonderfully. Now, did you want to do that now?
Actually, I wanted to thank you for the birthday message you sent me back in November.
Oh, yeah?
And secondly, how do you keep your voice so healthy?
As you can tell, it hasn't been completely healthy. I just did a Caps game. You're Washington Capitals. So we just shut down the Columbus Blue Jackets the other night, 5-0, and ended their 16-game winning streak. Now, I'm not one to rejoice in somebody else losing, but their coach is John Tortorella. And I know. I was very happy. Most everybody was very happy leaving the arena last night, except for those who had to go cover his press conference. So that was probably a whole lot of fun. Now, I've in the past 3 days, I have announced 11 Capitals goals, plus Unleash the Fury. And then I had other announcing jobs to do. Did a voice panel today. Cheered on Jan Johns and her voice panel all through the evening. Went upstairs for a second. Went like this. Hit the bed. I think it was about for 5 minutes till the party next door started. And then it was just sort of like 45 minutes of a fever dream. Until I ambled my way down here and found out that nothing was set up. And poor Recon was having to vamp up here for me for about 15 minutes. So let's give a round of applause to Recon Dye. Mostly a lot of room temperature water. I drink a lot of room temperature water. I don't do many lozenges. I will have some tea occasionally, but tea has a tendency to also dry me a little like diuretic. So just a lot of water. And you know what they say, a lot of water, a lot of peeing.
Of course. Thank you, sir.
I thank you. Howdy do.
Hello. This is a bit of an odd question, but...
Please, the odder the better.
My father fancies him to be a voice actor. He's always saying, like, when he hears about, oh, this and that voice actor, he'll just say, like, I could be doing that. And since you are from the area, like DC, he's located not that far from here in Virginia. Do you, would you know of any, maybe, like, places he could go that he could,
well, there are
like,
casting agencies in town that if you have a reel, and it's important to get a voice reel. Is he around? Does he come in here?
No, he's at home right now. He doesn't even know I'm asking him this. But
no, that's okay.
I'm just tired of him acting like a big shot and not putting his money where his mouth is.
Well, here's the thing. I've been coming to MAGFest since MAGFest 8. Mm-hmm. And I don't even know what number this is. It's now just 2017. Anybody know? 15? All right. So not so shabby. But every year people come up and they pretty much ask that question, which is, how do I get into voice acting? And I will tell people. I'll give them as much information as I possibly can. I can say that there's only one or two people who have ever really followed through with it. And that's the thing. It takes a lot of dedication and time. You've got to build yourself a demo tape. You've got to go out and buy equipment. And it's not all that expensive. You can build a small home studio. Or you can go to places. There's a guy named Ty Ford, T.Y. Ford, in Baltimore. And he's great. He helps build demo tapes for people. And there are teachers all around who will teach people the ins and the outs of voice acting. In fact, if anybody's interested in voice acting, Sunday at 10 a.m., also known as Hangover City, we are going to be in, I forget what room it is, could be this room, maybe this room. We're going to be doing the video game voice actor workshop. And John and Ellen will be there. John Patrick Lowry, Ellen McLean, Matt Mercer and Marisha Ray will be there, and I'll be there. And we're going to have some actual scripts from video games. We're going to have some actual scripts from commercials. And we're going to have some actual monologues. from movies, famous monologues from movies that people can read. And somewhere in the middle of that 2-hour period, I am going to read for an hour and 15 minutes another one of my stories. No, I'm kidding. I'm just kidding. No, we're going to basically let people read, get up and take turns, try something, and give you the experience like you're actually sitting in the booth and listening to feedback from engineers or directors, give you an idea on how to better your read, better your characterization, and to go deeper into the acting as opposed to just the voice. Your dad may have, does he have a really good voice?
When he was younger, he did theater, and he sings a lot, even now, after all this time. And he always gets compliments on his voice whenever he goes out to karaoke.
If he was in theater and he knows the acting, then he may be able to do very well. What I would suggest is that you go look at two websites, voice123.com and voices.com. And people have their demo reels on there. And what you should do is go on there, maybe go on with your dad, and look up, go look for some yourself first that you think might be the kind of voice that your father is. And listen to their demo reels. See if those are things that he could do. Because he's going to have to come up with a demo reel is about 2 minutes, little bits anywhere from 5 seconds to 15 seconds, clips that go through that demonstrate as a voice talent, who you are and what you can do. That's your calling card. That has to be built and sent out. There are casting agencies in D.C. if you wanted to. There's Carlin Davis Casting, Central Casting. You've got Pat Moran in Baltimore, Kimberly Skirm. There's so many agencies out there that you can get work with, but in order to do those things, you have to have a voice tape. And you can build for free your own page on voice123.com or voices.com and start using that as a calling card for people. So, you know, your dad can do these things, but you said it yourself. He's been saying for how long?
A couple of years now.
Couple of years. Has he made any efforts towards it?
No. He
just... That is it. You got to put the effort in. You got to actually do it. And if you do that, if you put the effort in and put the time into building the demo tape, into listening to other people and hearing what they're doing, and honing your own work according to what best showcases your talent, and then be persistent. There's a gentleman who you're going to probably see here soon. His name is Cyrus Namati. Cyrus would come to these panels every year, and he'd get a little advice and a little more advice. And every year he said, I'm going to do it. Now he's in San Francisco and he's voicing video games because he never gave up, because he kept going little by little, and he is going to make something out of himself. That's just it. It's the people who are either too persistent, too talented, mostly it's too stupid to give up.
That's, you know, probably him.
There's a lot of talent. You can have a ton of talent, but if you don't have the drive to go out and push, it's not going to happen.
Okay.
How are we doing, Recon? Yeah? They want us to get out of here. Okay, we have two people to come up.
Thank you.
You're welcome. You ask a question real quick. I'll give you a quick answer, okay?
You got it.
All right, what's the question?
All right, question is, I'm an aspiring voice actor myself, but aside from
Answered it. Thank you very much.
Aside from all the mumbo-jumbo, I actually am curious, what got you interested in voice acting?
Just acting. I was interested in acting first. Stand-up, sketch comedy. I started getting into radio, and I started using what I'd done on the stage with my voice on audio, and it just has grown from there. I definitely will tell you more about that if you come to the panel on Sunday at 10, okay?
Already planned on it.
Or Voice of Palooza tomorrow at 3:30, where it's going to be insane.
Already planned on that, too.
What's that?
Already planned on both.
Excellent. I'll see you there. You wearing the same hat?
No idea. I bought this to look like an idiot.
Okay, it's good. It works. Thank you. It's nice. I love it. I would wear it. Last question.
I was wondering, what were like the thought process and inspiration behind your voices for Lucien Lachance and Shea Gorath in Oblivion?
I'll tell you what. Hold that thought. Recon, do you know where we're going to go? All right, well, I will follow you. Guys, I am going to now disconnect. I'm going to follow Recon Dye to our super secret second location. Yes. If anyone wants to come with me, we will watch something
absolutely terrifying.